Hi, I'm a helpful Southern California Honda dealer. Over the past few months, we've been doing random acts of helpfulness, like treating people to free coffee, buying air conditioners for families in need, and holding helpful pet adoptions. And right now, we can help you, too, with great deals on award-winning Hondas, like the Accord, the only car to be named a Car and Driver 10 Best a record 29 times. Click the dealer locator link to find a dealer near you and go to SoCalHondaDealers.com to suggest a random act of helpfulness for someone you know. Car and Driver, January 2015.
Welcome to the 2014 edition of the 90 Degree Show, hosted by the Marching Podcast and Blog Talk Radio. Advice may be misleading, but examples are always clear. And here's your host, the Phantom Podcaster himself, Joe Beard.
Good evening and welcome to the 90 Degree Show. I'm your host, Joe Beard, and happy to be of service for you tonight. Today is November 23rd, end of November, 5 o'clock on the West Coast and 8 o'clock on the East Coast. We appreciate all those listening live and listening in podcast form, whether through Blog Talk Radio, our website, Facebook, Twitter, iTunes, YouTube, or whatever social media device, wherever you are on the internet. Whatever you have tonight. At the end of the broadcast, if you decide you like the show, then we appreciate a donation to the network, if you feel so in your heart, of course. Just simply go to themarchingpodcast.com and click on the donate button. Help improve the show and help build our scholarship fund. All right, tonight we have the great Florida Classic between Florida A&M and Bethune-Cookman. Similar to the Boombox, this is a huge rivalry in college sports, maybe the best rivalry or one of the best in college sports, and a good rivalry between the two schools being matched up there in the good state of Florida. This is a major matchup, and we are excited to talk about it tonight. Also got a chance to check out the old Capital City Classic, or the old Soul Bowl, if you want to call it, if you will, with Jackson State University and Alcorn State University. I got a chance to check out the halftime show. Did not see the fifth or anything else. But that formerly was a bigger deal for us and for me, especially when I crossed in 1997. How things have changed, but it's not the same, but we got a chance to see the halftime show from that event. Now, there are multiple matchups every week, and we can't touch on them all, but you can help us by calling into the number that you see there on the screen and fill us in on the experience in the matchup that we did not see. You can also call in to correct us on something or explain the feel of the crowd at the game that we're analyzing. Even if you disagree, we are all about saying so, and please do so. This is a show for the people, and just like science, we want to go through as much peer review as possible. So the format for tonight's show will announce the people who won the People's Choice Awards last week. Go to the website, themarchingpodcast.com, at marchingpodcast.com, and vote on who won the matchup, and I'll read that winner. I'll bring Rashad in, and we'll talk about the halftime show of Alcorn and Jackson State. In the second segment, we'll talk about the Battle of the Bands that happened before the game. Very similar, again, to the Boombox Classic, but I think they've probably been doing this longer there with the Florida Classic, and we'll talk about the halftime show there at the Florida Classic. There was not a zero quarter because FAM, I believe, did a pregame show, and I did not see that. I don't think I saw any video of that, and there was not a fifth because Bethune got a trophy, and they dipped out. You know, they probably felt, hey, let's go ahead and end this on a high note, you know, not potentially ruin the moment with, infusing ourselves in a battle, you know. So we'll go ahead and talk about those videos. And then in our final segment, I saw on the fifth quarter this week, someone from the BlueCoats Drum and Bugle Corps. I think his name was Derek, I believe. Forgive me, I didn't check out the name. I was more interested in a little bit of the dialogue little bit of the typical dialogue, but I just wanted to put it out there and just, you know, bounce it off Rashad or even bounce it off you as well. Call in 718-664-6025 and let us know how you feel about the message from the Bluecoats Drum and Bugle Corps. Wanted to get some information out to the HBCU bands. And so, you know, we want to go ahead and holler at folks about his message. So let's take our first commercial break. You can email the show at marchingpodcast@gmail.com. Tweet us at Marching Podcast or follow our blog, blog4.themarchingpodcast.com. If you are listening live and have a Blog Talk Radio account, I'm glad I said that because I knew it was something else I had to do. Let me go ahead and launch the chat room. It is launching up as we speak. Shout out to all the people in the chat room. We have definitely picked up a constant stream there. Of folks in the chat room every week. I see now, and even some folks telling me, yeah, sometimes I just want to call in and listen on the phone, but we don't have that capability to see if you want to be on hold or to mask the call. I could try screen the call. Let me see if that's possible. Rashad, can you hear me? I guess not. I guess I'm going to try to screen this call and see if it's actually possible. I don't even know what that button just did, but I'm sure if I disconnected Rashad, hey brother, you know, hit us back. But like I say, 718-664-6025. If you're listening live and you have a Blog Talk Radio account, you can listen there in the chat room. We got the chat room open. Someone's already there. Thank you for listening there in the chat room. let's see, your last and definitely not niece. Oh yeah, I said check out the website. Let's hear from our sponsors. Tonight's show is brought to you by Liquid Effects Photography, The Edge One Productions, Block Band Music, Bandhead.org, and HBCUBands.com. Let's take the time to hear from them now.
This is Curtis from 80MinutesOfRegulation.com. From referee's whistle to drum major's whistle and back, your source for sports and marching and athletic music. You're listening to the 90 Degree Show on the Marching Podcast Network.
Having an anniversary party, birthday party, or better yet, are you about to marry that special someone? Liquid Effects Photography is the perfect choice to immortalize all your most special moments. With 10 years of dependable professional service that can deliver from the conventional to the best in cutting-edge technology and creativity, come experience the uniqueness of Liquid Effects Photography. We serve the entire Upper Midwest and will travel further upon request. Come check us out at liquideffects.com. That's LIQUIDEFFEX.com. Or call us at 773-454-5556. That's 773-454-5556.
From photo shoots to graduation pictures, from probates to dance footage, from pageants to yard shows, there's only one team you can count on, the Edge One Productions. Visit theedgeone.com and trust me, you won't be disappointed.
Fan directors, have you ever found yourselves in this situation? Showtime is quickly approaching. Your budget is quickly disappearing. Your music choices are narrowing. The equipment condition is wearing and your stress level is mounting. Stop what you're doing and contact Block Band Music and find out how we've got you. Check www.blockbandmusic.com, providing music, equipment, gear, and accessories to show style, core style, and traditional bands worldwide.
What if there was a Facebook for bands? Wait a minute, there is. Bandhead.org. Bandhead.org is a social network for HBCU show bands. You can create your own profile and post videos, photos, and comments on Bandhead.org. Need somewhere to post events, audition schedules, job postings? Check out Bandhead.org. Are you recruiting for talent? Go to Bandhead.org. Bandhead.org, a social network for bands.
Hi, this is Thaddeus Dixon, Crab of 94 on the Sonic Boom of the South, graduate of Jackson State University, class of 2000, and you are listening to the 90 Degrees Show at the Marching Podcast Network.
Hey,
All right, we're back, and you're listening to the 90 Degree Show here on the Marching Podcast Network. You're listening to Alcorn bring us back in from the break with Life, Eddie Murphy and Martin Lawrence, and the Upper Room, bringing us back from a commercial break. I will bring our man Rashad in. What's going on, Rashad? How you doing today, man?
Hey, man. Feeling good, brother. Nothing going on. I didn't go anywhere this weekend again, man, so I finally started to feel a little bit relaxed.
Yeah, man, starting to wind down and starting to be the holiday season. Happy Thanksgiving to you. I might as well say that to the listeners and to you as well, since we won't be here before the next, Thanksgiving go around. This will be our Thanksgiving show or whatever. So happy Thanksgiving to you, man.
You too, sir. Happy Thanksgiving to you as well. And, of course, the next time we do a show, we will be talking about the ultimate Thanksgiving gift, Bayou Classic,
yes.
Baby.
Yes, the Bayou Classic. Definitely things that we are thankful for. That's definitely the Bayou Classic. And definitely thankful for the Bayou Classic because then, you know, it bursts little spinoff shows, as they say, just like we talked tonight. It's like the perfect segue into the Florida Classic. We will talk about that tonight. First, let me go ahead and get this out the way before I forget and talk about the winner of the Marching Podcast People's Choice Awards. I will pull it up here. Last week, I was definitely thinking about who I wanted. Either we're going to put Norfolk or if we're going to put North Carolina Central up there. But, you know, since the theme was the SEAC, I was going to go ahead and put it out there. Had a good little response from folks on Twitter. I heard more from the actual SEAC folks, and that was what's up. But, yes, I'll go ahead and read here the winner. I'll go ahead and we definitely got to get our sounds together. Man, we done added so many audio clips now. I'm scrolling down so many avenues now, man, to get to these sounds. Week 12 featured battle here with the Marching Podcast. You, the people, voted, and it's a sweep, ladies and gentlemen, with 100% of the vote. That is right, 100% of the vote. Tuskegee University. George Washington Carver and them and Benjamin O. Davis and them would be happy. But they have won the featured battle here. And shout out to Tuskegee. Shout out to Albany State as well. You know, I think that I can't remember what we said. I know Rashad and I were kind of like flip-flop, but we didn't necessarily have the clean sweep like that. Albany still representing. But, of course, hey, you know, Tuskegee's representing as well. So shout out to all the people that actually participated and voted. There on the network here. Okay, Rashad, we go ahead and get into our week 13 discussion. This week was special because it's like the week before Thanksgiving, so a lot of the rivalries are going down or like the special games. Folks is like cleaning up and realizing the smell of the end of the semester, so you know, either you're about to go home or, you know, you're about to move out the dorm. You got all type of stuff going on. And it's a really good time of year. Like you said, next week we'll be, you know, eating leftovers, watching the Bayou, I'm sure. And Thursday we'll be watching football and eating. So it'll be a really, really good time. And this week, of course, special rivalries. We had Jackson State and Alcorn, and we had the Florida Classic, which is our featured matchup tonight. The Jackson State-Alcorn game is not what it used to be. It used to be the Capital City Classic and was special for a lot of us at Jackson State because that was when our Crabs, I don't know the like PC term for Crabs. I'm sorry, White Shirts. Yes, the folks white shirts who wore white shirts crossed at that particular game. they were a part of the band or they made their section, blase, blase. I'm not even sure if that still goes down. I saw some quotes that it's like, you know, they didn't know, the old heads didn't know, like, when these people cross or what goes down. If anyone knows or if they care, it's all good, you know, let us know here on the network. Or, you know, I can keep it offline. All good. but I did check out the halftime show of Jackson State Alcorn. Rashad, did you get a chance to check out the halftime show of Alcorn? Okay.
Yeah,
so I I'll go ahead and ask you then, what did you think about the it's also also formerly called the Soul Bowl. What did you think about that matchup of halftime?
Honestly, it was kind of hard to say. I saw the video that I saw Jackson State from the back and from the side, and saw Alcorn State from the front, but also from the side. So it was really kind of hard to let me take that back. I saw Alcorn State from the back as well and from the side. It was really kind of hard to really give a true, unbiased opinion on what really happened there. I will say the number one thing, though, that caught my eye, though, Joe, is I've definitely got to give props to Alcorn's drum major. That drum major entrance that they did was pretty dope. I really, really enjoyed that. They did a couple things that I hadn't seen. Oh, like all the drum majors doing somersaults. I've never seen that before. You know, generally, you've got five drum majors, and you've got that one that's from the Universal Soul Circus, and he could do his thing. The rest of them, you know, something else back then. But all of them doing it, and they're doing some other cool things. That's really impressive, particularly when you're going up against, you know, Jackson State's drum majors, who are, of course, renowned. And, you know, I'm sure that there's many people that might say that the style of Alcorn is kind of biting off of, you know, Jackson's. I mean, but what can you do when your opponent is, you know, one of the best bands in the country? It's just some things that are going to be similar. Like, I'm sure when Bethune first really started getting big and started really doing their thing, initially, I'm sure there were some things about Bethune that were very similar to FAM. Just how it is until they continue to grow and start to develop more of their own style.
I totally agree. You know, well, a couple of things about what you said. One thing I liked about what the drum majors did, they did one move where, like, they got together in, like, fours, and they either did, like you said, either did a back bend together, like, all, I guess, where they, maybe their knees were able to support each other, but that whole kind of, that whole thing they actually did together, I thought was outstanding. They kind of ended it, like, where the guy was standing on the two other legs, you know what I mean, and the one guy doing the back bend. But I thought it was excellent. You know, I agree with you. I thought it was really good. And then to talk about, I was just going to say that today, that is a good theme about our show today with Bethune and FAM. There's so many things similar. Their announcer sounds similar to me. Like that
HD sound. We here with the Marching Podcast here, Rashad, and Block Band Music and Publishing.
I mean, you know what I'm saying? Both of them sound the same, you know. So like you said, and then if you know the history there about Alcorn, you know, was much smaller than what Jackson State used to be. And then Alcorn has progressed into what Alcorn is now. So, you know, and there are definitely a lot of similarities. And, you know, so many of their directors have been Jackson State graduates. You know, it's just because, you know, it's so similar. So, like you said, you can't help that until Alcorn is able to step up on the map, per se. And they do a good job. I think Alcorn is better than what they used to be. But, you know, they're still Bizarro State. You know, it's hard to get past, you know what I'm saying, Bizarro until, you know, they do something. They ain't there yet. You know what I'm saying? 718-664-6025. I agree. I saw them. I saw the tape probably that you saw. They both were from the back. So it was hard to say, like, who won. I definitely could tell it didn't seem like the Boom was into it. And I don't know if they were taking a bye week or, you know, it just seemed like they were just kind of like going through the motions of the show. But it definitely felt like, you know, they were resting their starters, so to speak, out there. With the show that they had, you know, and I don't know if they're looking past to, you know, the Honda or, you know, or what else is going on. Or it may, maybe you know, maybe the SWAC championship. I don't know of anything if they're going to have the same thing that they did last year, where the bands do the, you know, battle of the bands. You know, I don't know if that's going down. But, I mean, again, you know, I thought Jackson State from the back, it kind of rolls a little bit into about, like, we're going to talk about the end and about, you know, like DCI or, you know, we've talked before about predominantly white institutions and the difference in precision. One thing, man, is, and maybe, you know, Jackson State needs to pay attention, but I definitely noticed from the camera I saw the very first formation look very crooked. And okay, if the lines are going to be straight, it should be straight from all those different angles. So maybe this was definitely a time for some of the folks to step in and, you know, in practice or somewhere else, try to get some type of upper angle where they can see, you know, the difference in those angles of being straight. You know, if you're going to be straight on all sides, or if you can, you know, someone can say, hey, you know, we're incredibly crooked here from this view, I'm sure it will help. So that's one thing that I noticed. Alcorn didn't have as many of those precision problems from the angle that I saw, you know. Of course, you know, I heard from the threads that they formed a JSU and did that performance, a lot of the performance in the JSU, and then they marched off. You know, I thought maybe that was different, but still, I didn't see like a lot of energy, or I didn't see where it's just like, man, you know, they, you know, that the boom is doing a thing, you know. So, you know, but like I said, I know they can do better. We've seen them this year. I just maybe felt like they're going through the motions, and it definitely was definitely, I have to get used to seeing Alcorn. I'm just not used to seeing Alcorn Stadium or seeing, you know, bands or videos there of Alcorn Stadium. I'm just so used to seeing the Capital City Classic and people being in Memorial Stadium. That's just something I had to get used to. But I mean, I don't know. Based on what you've seen of both bands, I know we've seen a low. I guess it's too close to call to say who we think would win, unless someone could call in and let us know. What do you think, Rashad?
Well, I don't know that it's too close to call. I think it's just we couldn't call it because we couldn't see it. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. We couldn't really see what was going on. I mean, if we had to base it, though, off of what we've seen all year from both bands, then Jackson would be the clear winner. I mean, mm-hmm. Jackson has a much cleaner sound. They are the much better performing band on the field. They are, I mean, they're truly one of the best bands in the country right now. So if it had to be about that, it would clearly be Jackson. However, we all know that there are all those games where you come in sleeping, and if you sleep on the wrong band, that band will cut you. And so that's not to take away they couldn't have stepped it up. Unfortunately, just from the views, the angles that we were looking at, it was hard to tell. I will add this one caveat, though. When I was watching the shows and preparing, I noticed towards the end of Alcorn's show, I stopped paying attention. So
right,
maybe that's something, you know, about it. You know, maybe the dance team was a little wrong. I don't know. And that's a whole other conversation right there, Joe, about dancer teams and how maybe we need to start bringing a little bit more diversity, a few more things into it. Because there have been several conversations about dancer teams overall kind of being the low point of shows. And I agree with that. I think there needs to be some more thought. I completely disagree that dancer teams need to be gotten rid of. If you do that, then you lose your black people crowd.
Right, right.
So I think they need to be refined and put some more thought into them. And maybe that's what Alcorn needed to do. Because definitely at the end, I just kind of, you know, I started looking at something else.
Yeah. I mean, they were excited, and they had the energy. You know what I mean? That's what I really felt about the matchup. It's like, you know, hey, we're doing fine. Hey, yeah, blah. You know, we're excited. You know, we're at home. You know, and the Boom was just kind of out there doing their motions. I did give Alcorn that they did feel like the energy. They did better with that. And I definitely agree we are dead on with about the length of the dance routine. It was like they had three different breakdowns of the dance routine. You know what I mean? Like, they played, and then they put the horns down, and they wah, and then they start dancing and shaking. Then they pick their horns up, and they play, and then they do around, and then they put their horns down again, and then they did something. I was like, dang, they doing, I don't know if they're going to keep going, you know what I'm saying? But that's the thing. They could have cut that. You know, you can put your horns down and then do the whole breakdown and then march off. But that's, I noticed that as well. Maybe they wanted to give a little bit more to the home crowd. But I'm still not a fan. Jackson State did this too, but I'm still not a fan of, like, I don't know. It's getting kind of old when you're bringing somebody from the band out and doing their thing. You know, I think Jackson State had this guy out there doing something. Alcorn had something. Yeah, the folks, and then once something, have him out there embarrassing himself, you know, and then Alcorn turned around, had some guy out there, you know, not flipping and not doing nothing, like, you know, he's like doing them little halfway, you know, joints. And it's like, you know, I don't know, that's starting to get kind of played to me. But even still, like you said, we just can't call it. I'm looking here, we got a caller here from the 734 area code. Bring him in, caller. What's your name and where you calling from tonight?
What up, though? This is Jay from Detroit.
Jay from Detroit. What's going on with you, man? Triple plus platinum. What's going on with you, man?
What's up, man? I'm calling in to talk about that Florida Classic.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. I knew you was going to be on for that. We're going to talk about that after the break. But it's all good. I leave you on here. We'll finish up. We're about to wrap this one up anyway and then go to the commercial break. And then we'll go ahead and bring you on and talk about the Florida Classic. Did you get a chance to take a look at the video?
The Florida Classic?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Okay,
oh, yeah.
Okay. Okay, that's what's up. So, man, I'm just going to put you on pause. We'll wrap up Jackson State, do the commercial, and then we'll bring you back in, man. And you'll be able to hear it, so it'll be all good.
All right.
So, yeah, man, we go ahead and wrap that up. I think, like you said, we it's too close to say, like, because we just haven't seen you and we can't call. But definitely, you know, I will be interested to see. I didn't see that they did anything special or anything dope would make me like, oh, like, I think you and I about that wow factor. Alcorn didn't do that. But like you said, it just kind of got long for both of us at the end. Alcorn showed up, one, you know, at the end. So it's all
maybe
good.
Maybe the drum major should have made a dance routine because
right.
Their routine fight.
Yeah. Yeah. You know, it was a trip. You know what I mean? And just, yeah, like, I don't know. And like I said, man, I'm just not a fan. We need to kind of get rid of, well, not necessarily get rid of, but just featuring the folks. You know, I'm like, eh. You know what I mean? Not too big on that. We go ahead and get in early this first commercial break. That'll be all good. It is nothing wrong with that. So we'll go ahead and do that. I'll put Rashad here on hold, and we'll wrap that up. I'm sure if anyone out there in Jackson State at Tigerland or out there with the Sounds of Dynamite can call us in and let us know what happened, you're free to do so. No matter, we'll be talking about the Florida Classic here, but it's all good. You can still call in and let us know based on, you know, how the mood of the crowd was, blase, blase, blase. You're listening to week 13 here of the 90 Degree Show. We'll be back with the breakdown of the Florida Classic. They had the Battle of the Bands Friday, and they had the halftime, so we'll break on that. We got our man Jay on the line, too, so we'll be back here in the 90 Degree Show, week 13. Keep it locked, as they say.
Hey, this is Melita Wilson, alumni of Bethune-Cookman University in Daytona Beach, Florida, founder of HBCU Campus Tours, listening to the 90 Degree Show here on the Marching Podcast Network.
Having an anniversary party, birthday party, or better yet, are you about to marry that special someone? Liquid Effects Photography is the perfect choice to immortalize all your most special moments. With 10 years of dependable professional service that can deliver from the conventional to the best in cutting-edge technology and creativity, come experience the uniqueness of Liquid Effects Photography. We serve the entire Upper Midwest and will travel further upon request. Come check us out at liquideffects.com. That's LIQUIDEFFEX.com. Or call us at 773-454-5556. That's 773-454-5556.
Need to write music and drill? Get it on the field. Outfit your band. Keep your administrator happy and still have a life. Encountering drama in the process? Ain't nobody got time for that. Let Block Band Music assist you with musical arrangements and drills to fit your band. And also the equipment, gear, and accessories to keep the visuals, music, and marching on point. Contact blockbandmusic at gmail.com and see how this worldwide minority-owned business can uplift your band.
This is Joshua Cousin representing Ocean of Souls, and you're listening to the 90 Degree Show on the Marching Podcast Network.
All right, we're back from the commercial break, and you are listening to the 90 Degree Show here on the Marching Podcast Network. We are on the Florida Classic, our featured matchup tonight. One of the greatest, of course, like I said, in college sports. You are listening to Florida A&M, and I believe it's the Circus B, I believe the name of that march is. I'll bring in our expert, Rashad, here. Rashad, is that Circus B? Is that the name of this march?
Well, I'm told.
Okay. Just making sure that I had the name. I always messing up the names and stuff. But, yes, I love the marches. You know, I love it when people play marches. Love fam playing marches. It's kind of, you know, something they're known for. Definitely showing that full technical degree. But definitely, folks, we are talking about marching bands, so make sure you can play marches. 718-664-6025, listen to 90 Degree Show. We're here to talk about the great Florida Classic. The matchup is intriguing to me because of both bands, both programs, along with lots of sports, but definitely, you know, the history of both schools. Before I get into anything, or Rashad, I'll bring in our man Jay, alumni there of Bethune-Cookman Wildcats. Jay, what you think, man, of the Friday Battle of the Bands?
Man, Battle of the Bands. I think that Cookman had the energy as far as what you guys were talking about the dance routine earlier. It kind of made me think about specifically the energy that I saw from the dance routine. You know, they play on the field is an arena football field, so it's not a whole lot of drilling you can do. So the couple of things I was focusing on was the sound and how controlled the sound was inside the dome. And I wanted to say that both bands sounded good on their ballads, but I really liked that one that Fam played, that Whitney Houston. Oh, come on, what's the name of it? I Have Nothing?
Uh-huh.
I think that's what it was. But yep. Fan play, a ballad sounded good. Almost sounded like they had the 350-piece fam out there. But I'm sure it was the acoustics doing its
right
job. But
right.
Yeah, it was a nice one. It was a nice one. They did some percussion features. It's kind of hard to judge FAMU's percussion, man, because they pretty much I call them the beaters, you know, because they go out there and they just beat the drums, man. They don't even really – it's hard for me to see technical and precision and style or any of that. They just get out there and they just beat the drums like they playing for the Coming to America wedding or something. you know, Sudden Impact went out there. They did their job, man. It was clean. It was real. I really enjoyed the percussion feature. So I'm gonna give that to Cookman for the Ballad of Bands. But fam, you had they moments where they shined.
Okay. That's what's up, man. The first thing I noticed, I love the venue that they performed in. First off, I think maybe you guys had that Battle of the Bands for a while now, or maybe a couple years now. You guys have been doing that, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Probably well over 10 years.
Oh, okay. So they've been doing it for a while. But Boombox is super, super behind with that. So I love the venue, and I love that it was smaller. That was the main thing that, like, brought out to me what you said. You just talking about you can't do that much, and that kind of goes back to, for me, with, like, Cookman and just, I don't know, like, we started to see a lot more bands put everybody on the field. I think you should still drill with your 128. You know, or a smaller amount of folks where you do your patterns of motion or your high degree of skill. And then at the end of that, you can bring in everyone else from the sidelines, you know, for the dance feature and for the breakdown or whatever. But I don't know. Go ahead.
I was going to say, I was never a fan of that. I understand drilling with a set amount of people, writing your drills for a certain amount of people. Hey, the whole band can't go out on the field. You got some knuckleheads. You want to look clean. Thankfully, Cookman has been doing a good job with the, 200, however many people they got on the field, close to 280, something like that on the field. But I understand what you're saying, but to bring them on middle of the show, I don't know, but I don't like that. I don't like that idea. Fam do that during the Rattler back in when they 350 days. If you pay attention, when I was on the sideline, it blew my mind. When they do that rattle cadence, it was people coming on and off the field, people with uniforms rattling off the field, alumni switching hats with people rattling on. I'm like, what is this? But, you know, they don't do that no more. But, yeah, I see what you're saying, too, though.
Yeah, man. It's just, I guess, a difference of philosophy. But yeah, and another thing that kind of jumped out to me was Bethune-Cookman. Like, you know, it was just they didn't have that much room to do anything. They dropped the wings, and they did their thing. And, like, to your point, like, you know, the 280 looks good together. I think Rashad and I talked about this last week or 2 weeks ago. They like the old school Nintendo crowd where it's just one dude. And he, you know, he moving around at the football at the Tecmo Bowl stadium, and it's one dude in the entire stadium doing the same movements. They do that well, that uniformity. But I would love to have seen if they would have taken, you know, a smaller group out there for that venue, done a little something. Cause for me, when I saw the venue, and I'm gonna let Rashad say his thing. Fam did, because they were smaller, they were able to fill up the actual field more. Like, my visual for the video did more things with Fam, because Fam, they were able to rattle and they would do all that stuff. And whatever folks say about how they march out the field, it's definitely legendary how they do the and everybody hit the line and everybody, like, do the Superman. And then the people get in the circle and had their arms up going in the circle. That stuff's dope. And then my man, the Tuba man, come over there, do the little thing. Then they had the seniors. So it was the last time. You know, that was dope. You know what I'm saying? And I want to ask Rashad. I'm going to go ahead and let you do your thing, Rashad, because there was another part about Fam Show that I think, you know, me and you got to talk about. But definitely, I thought Fam was able to do more with the field. You know, Bethune was so big, they dropped the rings, they sound good, they look like the, you know, Tecmo Bowl crowd. But Fam was able to rattle, and they were able to do all that normal traditional stuff that we see. And I just think that added to their performance. What you think about the Battle of the Bands Friday night, Rashad?
Well, my closing statement is going to be that I completely agree with what you said about Fam there with that last thing. So I'm going to make my way back to that. But Joe Cookman came out, and they did a very good job. They started with the Sudden Impact drumline, and they are, you know, a good drumline. Now, the reason I say a good drumline and not an excellent drumline or awesome drumline, because in that venue, it's really hard to tell. And one thing that I think drumlines need to realize is they need to perform for your venue. For example, if you're performing for people right in front of you, let's say it's after the game, okay, and you're really trying to showcase how awesome that you are and how much better than you are than the other drumline, okay, then stand still and chop and just chop your brains out. But if you're in a big stadium like this one, you know, well, it's not huge, but, you know, a relatively big stadium like that one, standing still and chopping is not working for your traditional audience because they can't tell what you're playing. Even I have some idea of what the type of things that they're playing. I have no idea what you're playing. I don't know if you're playing paradiddles or doubles or what, because it's very, very hard to hear anything in a stadium like that. So in that sense, the percussion section has to be very visual as well. And they just didn't do that. You know, they just kind of stood in one place. And I'm not saying that they need to be cold steel. I mean, by no means do they need to change their style that way. But even the drum and bugle corps don't stand there. You know, if you're doing a percussion, you know, performance for the drum and bugle corps, let's say indoor performance, they're going to be moving around and doing some things that are interesting. And so I definitely think that if they're going to do something like that, they need to move around a little bit more, because the audience needs to see something, because the musical aspect of it becomes kind of null and void when you're dealing with a percussion section in a state. Just my two cents.
Go ahead. I'm sorry.
Go ahead.
Well, I was just going to say that I totally agree. That was my part about between the drum battles. I kind of broke my videos down. Like, I did the drum battles, and then I did the halftime show. I thought that Bethune's drum line, instant action? Sudden impact. I thought that they did like a drill. Like, I'm so glad you guys are win people, so you guys understand we don't be knowing what the percussion folks be doing. Like, it's exciting. Mm. It's exciting in the stands. And, like, when we go to Battle of the Bands, when we tired and you need a break and the percussion go out there, like, yeah, dog, you know what I'm saying? They start doing all that sticking. That's exciting. But like you said, we don't know paradiddle or, you know, like, oh, man, he hit a high C right there. Like, we don't know what's going on. So I appreciate – go ahead.
One thing I appreciate about Cookman Drum Station, now, to what you guys were saying, what it sounds like is they didn't water down their style because it's a battle. They're battling against FAMU's drum section. Now, crowd entertainment is involved with it, and the excitement is in the sticking. And if you noticed, I think Bethune-Cookman's tenor drums and bass drums have one of the best sticking percussion sections out there. I'm not going to say they're the best, but I notice them. And like you said, I'm a wind player. I play trombone. When I notice sticking from the tenor drums and the bass drums, it's got to be good, because unless you're a percussionist, you're not really going to just sit there and notice sticking. Now, it might be because it's my band, but I think they're one of the best sticking percussion sections out there. They didn't water themselves down and get all goofy and flip the, you know, do tricks and all that stuff. But I think it was pretty clear cut that they won that battle.
Well, yeah, we agree. That's what I'm saying. We agree. I think, but what I was saying, what they did was they had like an actual drill. Like they changed formations, You know what I'm saying? It was like it was a percussion drill, like that we actually drill before, you know, the dancer piece. It was like a drill. The actual the bass drums were like doing circles, and they was weaving in and out of stuff. And then I think like the little tenor drums was doing the little. It looked like they spinning on the hands, like, you know what I'm saying? It just looked like they changed formations a lot more versus fam. They had the African joints going on, which was, you know, black power, fist in the air, I understand, but they weren't doing anything. You know what I'm saying? It was just like a lot of sounds, and it was to the point, it was like, man, I could, oh, okay, this is cool because I can make sure my kids ain't doing nothing while this is going on. Like, you know what I'm saying? So yeah, I just appreciated Bethune's movement. And like you say, Rashad, just using up the field, appreciating the venue that the competition was in.
I actually
okay, go ahead,
first, let me agree with my man as far as tenor drums. I didn't notice the bass drums. I thought them spinning their sticks. I thought that was, wow, that's pretty uniform. They did exactly together. But I didn't notice much more than that. I actually was saying, Jim, I actually wanted to see more of that type of stuff from Bethune. I wanted to see them move around even more than they did.
Okay.
When you're looking at a drum line, this is something I would have said, well, I want all drum lines to understand, is that you have to understand that the audience doesn't have a clue of what you're doing. That doesn't mean don't do it. That doesn't mean don't do it at all. You still need to put out chop everybody in the world, but that just means you have to keep in mind that you have to add a lot of visual aspects to what you're doing. So that's, I would say they need to move around even more than they're doing, because if the time for you just standing still, or let's say if their snare drum is, you know, march up to the put the drums on the horn and just play right there. Okay, what's cool about that? You know, what is cool about that? You got to do some things that the audience understands. Oh wow, that was awesome. If you don't tell the audience, if you don't present your show in a way that tells the audience that was awesome, then they don't know. And that's the same for all bands. But anyway, that was them. Then after that, the rest of the band came out. I liked how they came out in the dark. I thought it would be even cooler if it was like a spotlight right there on the center and the whole stadium was like almost completely dark right there. And so when the lights came up, the whole band would have been there. That would have been tight.
No, oh, that would have been better, yeah.
Yeah, it was close to that, but it wasn't quite that. But it was still impressive. And, of course, you can hear on the tape, people are always impressed by a band that can take up the whole field. So I like Bethune being in that formation that ran from, you know, end zone to end zone.
Right.
Particularly looked much more imposing in the arena field than even the regular field. From there, it was to – the being in the arena was to Bethune's detriment, without a doubt. There's without a doubt being in there hurt them, because one of the things that Bethune-Cookman does fantastically is that they march very, very well. Their marching style is excellent. And you can see that when they're marching in one place, but it looks a lot better when they're moving around and making different things. And since they couldn't do that in that place, I don't know that it was a thing about them, the size of the band. I think it's just that they had a show on Saturday and really weren't trying to do a show on Friday. I have to say, I don't think they were trying to learn another drill in a completely different size.
I heard that.
But that hurts them because they're very good at that. It takes away one of their best strengths. I thought they sounded very, very good. I enjoyed their dancing team. I enjoyed pretty much everything about them. However, when Fam came out, the drum line thing, I don't even know if that was like their drum line versus like their percussion ensemble. It was different. You know, they had their the guys going on for a little while. I thought it felt a little long, but it was different. It had been playing. I think he was playing the steel drums or something like that. Yeah, he was playing the steel drums. And then the band came running out there. That transition between the percussion section and the band running out was not very good at all.
Like, horrible.
Transition, yeah, but those transitions from drum line to band was very good. But FAMU was kind of like, here's this other thing, here's this thing. And then here's another thing that had nothing to do with the first thing at all. They just kind of ran out there, and I wasn't really feeling it. I also wasn't feeling at all the fact that they were still having to put up with the percussion stuff Have you noticed people running back and forth, putting the stuff up, and then running to get in their spot? You know, so when fam comes out on the field, automatically, therefore, at a formation standpoint, they were definitely at a loss versus Bethune-Cookman. Because you look at fam's band, you see all these holes all over the place. And then slowly but surely, the holes start to fill in. You know, you're
right.
You know, definitely should have fixed them. Now, beyond that, but fam you sounds fantastic. Man, I mean, wow, what an amazing difference that they have made in the course of a year. They sound incredible. They have a very, very clean and controlled sound. But at the same token, it's a very big sound for their size. Like, it definitely, it's not like Bethune just came out there and just completely drowned them out, being over twice the size of FAMU. But FAMU definitely have a sizable sound, and I really appreciated that. I would go to say, for that battle, here comes the hate mail. For that battle, I would go so far to say that FAMU sounded better than Bethune-Cookman. And Bethune-Cookman sounded great. But FAMU, I thought for the half, now let me say this again, for Friday night, I thought that Bethune-Cookman sounded better.
It was the dome, man. It was the dome.
I was...
It was that dome.
From there, the rest of the performance was good, but I think that just the, you know, Circus B, that was awesome too. I just think the sound was the main thing that did it for me. The other thing, like you said, Joe, was you got to give respect to that rattle off the field. I mean, you just got to.
Man.
It's cool. And I personally am not a follower like Sam like that, so I haven't seen it in a long time. But that's hard work, man. You know,
man, that's what you like. I mean, I guess.
yeah, right.
I mean, look like a bunch of people dragging their feet on the floor.
And they do it at 150 beats a second, right?
Yeah, right, right,
or
right.
Or something like that.
You know,
got glue stuck on the bottom of their shoe. They're trying to get it off.
You know, but it's different, though. It's not like, okay, here we go. We're going to march again. You know, they did something different. And then the tuba player, the only thing I wasn't really feeling about the tuba player is, can we just cut it down to one person? Because really, really hyped about the last guy. Like, oh, man, that man, that was hype right there. Oh, he wasn't the last.
Right. I'm thinking it was because of they were seniors and they were getting their last little, like they were seniors. Because I'm sure they got some type of system where only sisters or, you know, supreme upperclassmen get to do that joint at the end. And I'm sure like for every game they maybe switch it out or whatever. But I'm guessing that that's what it was. That got me too, Rashad. I was like, oh, that's that. And then the drums were still going. And my man was like, last time. And it was just like, okay, this ain't the last one. But they did a good job of hiding. Or maybe I need to look at the video again. I wasn't looking for them. But I swear I didn't ever see another one behind the one that was, you know. I was like, damn, where'd he come from, you know?
The camera went back over there. What? Another tuba?
Yeah,
man.
The alumni, he came out the stands with a tuba.
Right.
I'm telling you.
He didn't get the chance to do the 2012.
Right. You ain't right.
That's what's up, man. But, yeah, man, I totally agree with you, Rashad, man. I think we pretty, between you two, I pretty much said the same things. Only thing, like I said, jumped out to me, I wish their drum section, they featured the dancers for a second, but yeah, I thought that, you know, Bethune, you know, out-drilled them per se in the drum section. And then Fam came out, and I love that they played a march. I think, you know, I already said that. I love that they played a march. And I wasn't thrilled, though, Rashad. This is the part I was going to bounce off of you. They did a little bit of – they had church service up in there a little bit. You know, and I mean, oh, God, here we go again, man. I was just like, man, damn, man. I was like, okay. I was like, I understand. And I will say, though, when they played the song and the director turned around and then directed to the crowd and then the actual crowd sang the song, I'm sure the folks out there in FAM was actually singing too, but the actual crowd sang the song. I thought that was cool, and that is still gimmicky, but at least they were making the crowd sing. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. See, it was a little bit different there for you, Rashad, man. They were still getting with Jesus, and I still like, I'd like to keep that separate right now, but still. But I thought it was cool how the directors, you know. So I thought with that, I thought that showed a lot of showmanship. Then the fact they were able to use up more of the field. The only thing still, man, FAM does a lot of playing. And Bethune does it too, but they do so much kicking and bouncing and skipping when they playing, man. Oh, my God, calm down. You know, maybe that's a theory thing or philosophy, but, wow, we're impressed that you can play and dance. That's outstanding. You know, we'll put you in the Guinness Book of World Records. I'd rather not lose the sound when you turn around and you jump up in the air. You know what I mean? I don't like hearing the song and it's like, well, it's like you listening in waves or something because
see,
people are turning.
Let me say one thing, though. That's the thing with Cookman. See, when we do it, it sounds, the sound is not distorted. The sound doesn't change during our dance routines or when we're in the stands or when we're marching. This sound is a consistent wall. There's no break in it. And, you know, of course, obviously, if you're doing a full spin while you're playing, it's going to turn around. But I haven't really seen Cookman do that, but maybe for the one note in the dance routine. But it's not something
FAM
that
does
we
a lot.
Yeah, FAM does a lot.
They put their horns to the ground a lot. I mean, I understand you dancing. That's great. But still, you know, that part, you know, I can kind of do without. As far as Cookman goes, you know, I think we basically – I just didn't think that there's nothing that really jumped out about their show. They were able to drop the wings. I think I agree with you as far as, you know, people coming in and the full band from end zone to end zone, definitely looking imposing. And also the video. Shout out to the video folks for the summer band camp. That looked really, really good. Like before – the band, or while the band is actually coming out, the guy with the camera actually goes up to the jumbo screen and actually you see, you know, the commercials for the school. And they showed a lot of the formations and the animations throughout the years that they're forming. So just showing not so much of the dance and the juke moves, as they say, they showed a lot of the flashing of the different formations that Bethune-Cookman has been doing. So I thought that was really good from a recruitment standpoint. But also we've talked about precision and, you know, the Ohio States and, you know, the drum and bugle corps and all that. That video showed that Bethune is definitely one of those bands that makes, you know, the animations or makes the formations. And we'll talk about that definitely in the next hour or in the next break when we talk about the halftime show. But I thought that was something that was special as far as Bethune is concerned. Like I said, the drum section changed formations a lot, so I felt that they won. Only thing, again, that did would kind of turn me off with Bethune's show, nothing jumped out at you because, you know, it was, you know, too big for the venue. But they did they played the alma mater at the end. I was like, you know what? That might be worse than leaning on Jesus a little bit. I don't know. I mean, brother, I love all my HBCUs. But when you play the alma mater, oh, you hit me in the heart. You ain't got nothing else to do but, like, take off your hat and stand up and pay respect and do all that stuff. Don't play the alma mater. I mean, come on, man. You tugging right there. And I was just like, oh, Bethune, you hurt me with that one. Y'all going to make everybody stand up on the alma mater, man? Oh, like, I mean, oh, that hurt me, man. So I was surprised.
Pride for you, man. That's why they call it the pride.
Oh, man, that just got me. I was just like, man, that was something right there. Because at least people didn't even stand up when they had the little church part with fam. They didn't even stand up for the Jesus part. But, man, you're going to have to stand up for alma mater. So that kind of surprised me. So I gave the drums to BCU, and I gave the show to fam just because they was able to do more with the show despite the church service. And I think, what did you say, Rashad? I think we all agreed about the drum show, but what about the actual field show of the band?
FAMU. I definitely give it to FAMU.
And then our man Jay, of course, you stick with Bethune, of course, of course, of course.
I'm a sticky with Bethune, but I'm also give FAMU much props on their sound, and especially the sound on that concert selection at Whitney Houston.
Yeah, and definitely to your credit, though, Jay, man, it was, I definitely could tell the difference just giving a little snippet, little snake to the next, so people can listen in the next segment. I definitely noticed the difference from outside and indoors between the bands, you know what I'm saying, like on the video.
I'm ready to get to that one, too, yeah.
Right. Right. Well, that's what's up, y'all. Right on time here, I had to adjust my little transition music here between the different times. So we pretty good. We here with the 90 Degree Show week 13. I'm going to put y'all on pause. We'll do our last commercial break here, and we'll talk about the halftime show. But we're also going to throw in our word on the street here in this last hour. We got 2 hours, y'all. We had to fill up the time because Rashad and I, you know, we can't fit everything in. And, you know, if we got the time, if we got the allotted time, we're going to use it. But at least we got this next hour here to talk about the halftime show that we saw. And, of course, you know, wrapping up the good old Florida Classic. But we also want to get into our word on the street. We got a post. I'll give you guys a little bit of information here from the BlueCoats here on Drum Corps Planet. It was an actual post on Drum Corps Planet. And then, of course, some of our good folks here on the 5th actually sent it this way. I was actually intrigued and left a comment myself. But some folks out from BlueCoats offering scholarships from folks at HBCU bands trying to reach out based on things he saw from YouTube. Yes, that's right, y'all. For all us folks that are there at the games, right, able to fill us in on what's going on. Basically, what this show is about, breaking down those bands, someone's noticing that and trying to get some love with DCI, essentially opening the door. We'll talk about how you guys feel about that here and the end, the halftime show of the Florida Classic when we come back. Week 13, 90 Degree Show. Thanks for listening, y'all.
Hi, this is Thaddeus Dixon, Crab of 94 on the Sonic Boom of the South, graduate of Jackson State University, class of 2000, and you are listening to the 90 Degrees Show at the Marching Podcast Network.
What if there was a Facebook for bands? Wait a minute, there is. Bandhead.org. Bandhead.org is a social network for HBCU show bands. You can create your own profile and post videos, photos, and comments on Bandhead.org. Need somewhere to post events, audition schedules, job postings? Check out Bandhead.org. Are you recruiting for talent? Go to Bandhead.org. Bandhead.org, a social network for bands.
From photo shoots to graduation pictures, from pro base to band footage, from pageants to yard shows, there's only one team you can count on, the Edge One Productions. Visit theedgeone.com, and trust me, you won't be disappointed.
Chopping It Up is a podcast of one-on-one interviews with positive role models that have a connection through music and or education. Chopping It Up is all about inspiring our youth for a great future and providing a roadmap on how to get there. We also chop it up to give insight to anyone looking for information or hope in their endeavors. Chop it up with us on Tuesday at 9 p.m. Eastern at blogtalkradio.com/marchingpodcast. Chopping It Up, changing the world through positive interaction.
This is Warren Shaw, Chief Arranger and the voice of the Clark Atlanta University, Mighty Marching Panthers. You are listening to the 90 Degree Show on the Marching Podcast Network.
Definitely changed the mood. I was all hyped up and ready to come in back in this last segment. I'm like, yeah. And then Bethune come back in and slow it down super smooth for us. But yes, you're listening to Bethune. I'm going to have to bring Rashad back on the line to tell me the name of the song. Please don't pull my black card. But I was about to say Easy Like Sunday Morning.
That's why you bring me on the
table.
Stairway to Heaven.
That's what it's. Stairway to Heaven. I'll bring our man Jay back on so he listens to the good alumni while he's in the background. But 718-664-6025, you're in the last segment here. We're wrapping up the Florida Classic. You listen to, I think they played this at the Battle of the Bands. But we're here and we're going to talk about the halftime show now between Florida A&M and Bethune-Cookman. You are welcome to call in at any time or leave your chats there in the chat room. Shout out to all the people in the chat room and thanks for listening. So, yes, the halftime show now. So we take the battle outside. Yes. Yeah, so Jay, let you start, man. What did you think about the halftime show between Bethune and Fam?
Well, who you want me to start with?
Let's go with Fam first.
All right. Yeah, I was actually pretty impressed with Fam, man. You know, they started out with the rattle. They came out there five drum majors deep. You know, I was laughing because they are still trying to surround the field like they used to do, but they can't do it. So, they stretched out from one sideline, and then they went to the other side of the field, from sideline to sideline they tried to, or end zone to end zone, and they came in, did the four lines, they rattled in, and then they played a little fanfare. Sounded pretty good. What was they? I can't remember their slow song, because what impressed me was their actual formations. Now, I hate how they drill. I hate how they get to their formations.
Me too.
They follow the leader drills, and they usually do these stick man formations. But they actually did some pretty cool stuff. One formation they did was I guess the song was kind of weird to play on the field. They played the Ohio Players Love Roller Coaster, and then they made a roller coaster hill, and with the car,
right,
went up the hill and came down. That was creative, and I never seen them do that. That was pretty cool. And then they said they made a guy on the field. They made someone doing a nay-nay, and then they kind of did the arm waving animation and tried to make it look like they was doing the nay-nay. So that was, kind of ratchet and cool at the same time. But, It was pretty bad. Now, sound-wise, they were exposed because
right.
I don't know if it's the arrangements or the way maybe it's some people that was in the band from years ago. Maybe they got a lot of juniors, a lot of seniors in their band that's still playing to their old size, but they're not playing like true to size. When I say that, I mean it sounds like the arrangements are made for a big 350-piece band, but the arrangements don't cater to their sound. You hear a lot of holes, you hear a lot of people dropping out. You hear some woodwinds, some clarinets sticking out, and that stuff that I never remember hearing from Fam. I never remember hearing Fam drop off their whole notes and not hold notes out for the full value and stuff like that used to be over-exaggerated with Fam. It's like every measure was almost tied together. Everything was legato and smooth but this was a broke form of that, and it wasn't. I didn't enjoy it from a sound standpoint. It sounded pretty bad. I mean, borderline. It sounded pretty bad. They had their moments, but it sounded bad for the most part. Now on to Bethune-Cookman. You know, man, we executed, bro. I'm not gonna lie. 110% effort. High energy from every person in that band. All knees were lifted. I challenge anybody to zoom in on somebody and show me somebody that was in March of 90s. From beginning to the end of the show, sound was there. Energy was there. I kind of don't know what that formation was they made. They made like a little, looked like a smiley
emoji.
Face.
Yeah, it was supposed to be an emoji. Y'all getting hit on the fifth about that too. Of course, some folks is already.
I didn't know what that was. Thank you for explaining that to me. But okay, emoji. Outside of that, I mean, but they drilled to that mug. I mean, lines was clean. Wasn't no lost squad out there. You know. But that's what Cookman does. We come out there, you know, we have a real strong intro, and basically all our shows are formatted the same way. You know, we come in with the intro, we start our drill, or we go to the BCU, then we do our drill. This time we did the BCU at the end. But for the most part, getting to that formation was clean. Coming back to that formation, bringing it back to block band and going in the concert band formation, that transition was clean. The concert selection, man, that I will never lie to you day and night.
Yeah, whatever that song, I don't know. All the time.
That make condition.
Hold up, guys. My phone was on mute. Can you sing that again for me? I missed that.
I can't wait to get the... I don't know what this... somebody got to let us know.
I will never lie on you day and night.
Those are bad songs.
All I do is think of you, baby girl.
Day and night. Yeah. There you go. Those are bad songs.
I don't know if I've heard anyone play that. Have y'all?
Oh, I'm sure I have.
You probably have, I'm sure. Yeah, exactly.
And then, you know, the dance routine was an assortment of the day's hits. And, of course, the Nene was featured. They cranked that Nene once, one good time. Then they came out, did the BCU, and did another dance routine right when they was about to end with the three notes, so Let's Go Wildcats. And then they switched it up, did another dance routine, hit the three notes, Let's Go Wildcats, strong, finish strong, boom, that was it. Oh, and Dancing Girl Selection, 14K was beautiful.
Rashad, what do you think about the halftime show?
All right, I'll go ahead and start with Bethune since they performed first.
Okay.
Let's see here. So they entered with the drum majors with the smoke, which was, I don't know, sometimes that goes okay. When it works out, it goes great. But unfortunately, smoke goes wrong a lot of times. And a lot of times, nobody can see anything. And that was happening. I'm sitting there with the trumpet players coughing and stuff, but they didn't want their sights taken, so they just stood still like they've been trained to do. You know, but for a while there, sometimes you really couldn't see anything going on. But it was cool, it was a creative idea. If bands could figure out how to make that work all the time, it would be awesome. But a good overall entrance on the drum major. Halftime Saturday was really Bethune's opportunity to shine because they were able to do that thing that they do better than almost anybody, which is march. And I agree with my man completely. I don't necessarily say that they all march 90s, but I will say that they all march exactly uniform. I'll probably give them a good 70,
uniform. 70,
but they are uniform to a team, man. I mean, it's amazing to watch them. I mean, outside of just seeing a different instrument between different people, it's almost hard to completely to notice that these are different human beings. I mean, it's amazing. You've got to give them that credit. And so that is a major thing for Bethune because obviously they didn't really have that to their advantage on Friday. I thought their drumming was well. Now, like you, I have no idea what they made. And you guys tell me that it was an emoji. Means nothing to me. I looked it up real quick while y'all were talking, like, okay, is this a smiley? Okay, they made one of them smiley things? Okay, I still don't know what it is. I couldn't tell which emotion they were showing.
I'm a man said emotion. Yeah, man, I know you got a smartphone, but at the bottom, you can hit the little face dude and all the little joints show up. Now, I don't know which one it was, though. I don't know which one it was.
See, I thought they were about to make the face from Latch because they started playing Latch on the field. Like, oh, they're about to make the face from Latch. That's cool because, you know, anytime the two people in the video were, you know, like, digging each other, they had that particular face that would show up. I thought they were going to make that, but they didn't. They made somebody know what it was. Now, here's the thing about Bethune. Bethune is excellent. I think that the whole band world, except for Bethune, people that went to Bethune are behind me on this. Everybody's behind me. Let our powers combine. Bethune is excellent at uniformity. Bethune-Cookman just doesn't have any type of, bam, you didn't know we were going to do that. Mm-hmm. It's kind of like the man said, like Bethune's exciting thing they did yesterday was they made BCU at the end of the show. That's how they switched it up, man. They came to the band room and said, listen, guys, we're going to switch it up. Listen, we're going to make BCU at the end of the show. And people started passing out. In the meantime, the rest of us were like, okay. And that's really, I really wish Bethune would kind of do some more things to kind of get out of that. Like, they made the one thing. They made one thing, and then they're back to concert band formation. Like, come on, guys. Like, you guys are so big. You could really make a lot of things, you know, but they didn't do it. So, okay, there you have it. They definitely have a high marching and maneuvering score, but for general effect score is kind of okay. Like, they're really good at what they do, but maybe it would be better if they did some more credit. Their sound was very good outside, really, really good sound. I enjoyed the baby girl there. And dance routine I thought was good. Once again, extremely uniform. I liked how they made BCU, and then instead of playing the last note of BCU, they went into like another dance type of deal and then ended the show. So it was a very, very sound show. I think it's the same show you're going to get from Bethune-Cookman every game. And honestly, I haven't seen Bethune-Cookman every game. But I believe that every time you see them, they're going to be that good. I believe that's the case. They're going to be exactly the way you saw them. They're going to be that good. Now, FAMU coming out on the field, okay? So FAMU comes out on the field. Thank goodness everybody comes on the field at the same time this time. And right from the beginning, you notice that the sound wasn't the same. The thing that really put them over the top for me yesterday, maybe it was the dome on Friday, I mean, but on yesterday on the game, I just, mm-hmm. you could hear it. Wow, this doesn't sound as good. It's just not as tight. You can hear people sticking out. I wouldn't say it was bad by any. I wouldn't say it was bad, but it definitely wasn't what I thought that I heard on Friday. I guess somebody's gonna quote me on that. What I thought that I heard. it was cool that they made the M100 at the beginning, but then FAMU finally came back. Finally came back, dog. Just like you said, Alcorn finally came back. FAMU finally came back. After we have been talking about, wow, we like this new fam and how they drill, then the get their drills came back.
Yep.
Yep. Over there, you go over there, you over there, you follow him. can't stand it, man. They brought that stuff back. Then they made some type of monster or something, and then the monster picked up something and, like, drank the drum majors.
Oh, yeah, I didn't even know what that was. I forgot about that, man. I didn't know. Man, I didn't know what that was.
And I wasn't sure who the person was supposed to be. You know what I mean? Like, that wasn't. That's another thing, too. I think, Rashad, you brought it up about just the announcers. Make sure the announcer is doing well. If there's some type of animation, we need to know kind of what's going on. You know, it's just a random guy taking a drink. You know what I mean? It had four drops in it. I mean, I don't know. What's going on? Break it down to me. Or make it cleaner so we know. You know what I'm saying?
And normally, like my man said, they normally do those stick figures. So it's pretty simple to see, hey, this is a stick figure taking a drink. But I didn't know what that was that time, and he didn't say what it was. I thought the roller coaster was really, 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 really creative. I thought it was really, really cool. I thought it was really, really poorly executed. I thought the humps, the curves on the thing, like they weren't smooth at all. Like it was just a lot of, like if you rode that roller coaster, dog, you would have flown off, you know. And so really, that is the thing that really ends up giving it to Bethune. Because to me, it took me a second to figure out which one that I agreed for more. But here's the thing. I think FAMU's show was much more creative. And they really tried to get outside the box and do a lot of different things and showcase a lot of things. But here's the thing. You don't win because you took the prettiest shot. You win because you made the baskets.
Wow.
And they took pretty shots. They took some pretty shots, man. They did some stuff. They tried. They tended to do some stuff that was off the chain. But they didn't necessarily execute it that well. Versus Bethune-Cookman, they did some things that are much more simple. They made one formation and got done with it. But they did it perfectly.
Preach.
So you got to give it to Bethune for that. But I look forward to FAM starting to nail that stuff. Because like I said earlier, I give FAM one more year, maybe two, before they're really one of the best bands in the country again. I mean, they are really developing really fast.
Wow.
Yeah, I think I totally agree. You know, what's interesting about you say is just kind of that execution, that lack of tightness sometimes in some areas, or that just lack of discipline sometimes with FAM. You know what I'm saying? It's just like that lack of, it's like, you know, just kind of like, or going back to Friday night when, you know, like you said, like they had the drum show at the beginning, boop-a-doop-a-doop-a-doop, and then the band comes in. Well, the whole band really doesn't come in. You see the band start playing and then snippets of people filling in here or there, you know, and then you see holes and then it's like, oh, okay, then they're filling in. And there were people actually filling into that after the actual introduction piece was finished. You know what I'm saying? So it's stuff like that about FAM where it's just like, oh, man, like, so I definitely saw that. My thing, I think we talk about BCU, they don't do anything that jumps out. They don't take too many risks. You know, they don't do too much stuff that's like outside the box, and you kind of hope that someone will kind of do something, because the announcer, and even both schools had this, it seemed like the announcer was doing a lot more of the talking. Like, yes, fam, this is how it's supposed to look like. Peep out the nay-nay, fam. Do you see that? You know what I'm saying? So it's like, y'all should show me on the field. But I think what's special about them is the consistency of the execution. Just like you said, you're going to see BCU this week,
And then 4 weeks from now, they're going to execute the same way, to the same degree, same intensity. They all going to march the same. They all look – you don't know who's the big person or the little person in the band because they're marching the same, the uniformity. And, you know, maybe that's the calling card. You know, you're going to see greatness all the time when you see it. I just want to see greatness and then maybe do a backflip. But don't get too gimmicky. You know what I'm saying? Don't get too gimmicky. Start singing or something like that, you know. But I would like to see some little punch in the face, you know, something that, you know, BCU would do. Fam, it was like, you know, okay, they sound different because they outside now, you know. And I was like, okay. But I did give them credit for the higher degree of difficulty. But like Rashad say, you don't get credit for being Kobe. You get credit for, well, not being Kobe. You don't get credit. What is it? The prettiness of the shot. You don't get credit for taking the shot. You get the credit for making a basket. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. I think that Fam, they did some good things. I thought they did more to the eye. It's very similar with Friday. I find myself interested in Fam. Like, oh, what they about to do now? But like you said, the execution. One thing about the car on the roller coaster is that the back wheels weren't on the track when it was going up the hill. You know what I'm saying? It's the small little details like that. I mean, hey, I understand it's animation. It wasn't perfect, but it's got to be if you out the Florida Classic and you trying to put down your rival. You know what I'm saying? but yeah, I think BCU, they execute. I just wish that. And I'm going to say this, the same thing happened last year. I wish that BCU took more advantage of Fam being down. It's like they ain't really grab them by their neck and put them down like they should be doing. Go ahead, man.
I'd like to see that, you know, that punch in the face that you're talking about, that something different that Cookman hasn't done. I would like to see that come in the stands, because that's one thing that I really, really miss from Cookman's band, is that good, putting in that good work in the stands. Because I was actually surprised a couple years ago when I saw him go against Tennessee State, that they had like a 3-hour battle in the stands, and Norfolk, they had like a 2-hour fifth quarter, and that don't happen often with Cookman. And at the Florida Classic, I don't ever remember seeing a fifth. I mean, one, two songs, usually Cookman leaves from my memory. But during the game, what I heard, the power I heard from Cookman, I thought, you know how when you're watching a game and the music comes in and they're about to go to commercial break and all the background noise just goes out and you just hear the music like, okay, they're about to go to commercial break. That's what I thought was happening. But it was Cookman Band playing. And I was like, oh, my God, these dudes are loud. He filled up everything. You heard nothing. You heard nothing. You just heard band. And I was like, man. If I could just get like a good 12 rounds in the fifth with them and Fam, you know, or some nonstop blowing from them in the fourth quarter, you know, it was an intense game. That's why I don't think they really played that much in the fifth, as far as back and forth, because the game was so close and everybody was on the edge of their seat. But that's where I would like to see that punch in the face come. I want to see Cookman take some risks in the stands, play more new music, new up-to-date rap tunes, you know.
Do you guys play marches? Does Bethune play marches?
Oh, yeah, we play marches, yeah.
Okay.
I don't even recall ever hearing a march, ever.
Trombone King is the one that I remember playing all the time.
What year did you march it at Bethune?
2001.
Okay. So yeah, man, I guess that's the thing about them, man. I just, you know, Bethune, they execute, they elegant, you know, as they say. I guess it's just the risk factor. We definitely want to see Bethune take more risks. But still, I give Fam the props on the show. They had my eye. You know, they have me definitely interested in transition. Do not like the messy transitions. You know what I mean? With what they were doing. But still, I thought that they had a good show. It's just, you know, they had a higher degree of difficulty. You know what I mean? They just didn't stick the jumps, as they say. So it was a, I guess it was a switch for me. I had, so I guess we are the same. Well, my man Jay, I know you got 2 for 2 with Bethune. But yeah,
sweet.
We had the sweet, right.
About.
So we had Fam Friday, and then we have Bethune for the actual Saturday of the actual halftime show. The folks said there wasn't 0 quarter because Fam actually did a pregame, and then I think Bethune got a trophy at the end of the game, and then after that, you know, they didn't have to stay after that. And then they said that Fam stayed there and played a couple songs for the crowd. So, again, you let us know. This will definitely be our People's Choice Awards voting on the marchingpodcast.com. All the people out there listening, all you in the chat room, you guys can go there this week and to vote on who you think won. And we will say the winner here next week. I got to double check about the schedule. I don't know. Oh, yeah, it's the Bayou Classic, of course. That's what we'll be talking about next week before our break, I believe. Well, no, I think we got a couple other things like the SWAC Championship. We'll see. I got to check out the schedule. I'm digressing right now because it's towards the end of the show. We're here with our word on the street, and
hey,
I wanted to throw this.
I'm sorry, go ahead.
Can
I interject something real quick?
Go ahead.
When I saw this, I was so mad, boy. I almost cussed. Ooh, boy. Keep your football players off the field. Seriously. We don't come on the field. Unlike Drumline 2 shows, we don't come on in the middle of the halftime to do a Drumline show. So please keep your butt off the field while the band is performing. I was pissed off, man. Did you see when they show the? Did you see the version of the show where you see FAMU from the back? And
no.
And the football player. You didn't. Oh my God! There is.
Yeah, it was like three of them out there. I saw that.
There's a kicker like right next to the band, and I don't know if he was actually literally kicking over the band, or was he just pretending to kick, man? But he was like he was within 5 yards of some of the people on the band, and when as the band started to leave the field. He went to the center of the field. It is disrespectful, man. Unless FAMU was overtime, which it might have been, if they're overtime, then I'll take it back.
Well, they had a problem with this with the clock. The score clock was malfunctioning, and they had to stop using the score clock that was on the big screen and use it on the one on the field. And there was some of that stuff going on too.
Well, man. I just had enough. I mean, I saw it happen, you know, with the NFL player from Bethune. I mean, from the Carolina Panthers, I think, against Bethune.
Yeah, you're right.
But
I thought that was a one-time thing. But to see that, again, from a college player, it's like, dude, like, keep your butt off the field.
You know, and
the fact that the band is still performing, I don't care whose time it is. Stay off the field.
It's funny, too, because – It's funny, too, because it's a kicker, and in both instances as a kicker. And then if you extrapolate that, when you always talk to football players or you watch the football shows, they always talk, you know what, about the kicker. Or, I don't know if you guys have seen Any Given Sunday, but the big lineman, the guy, he plays Latimer on the program, big crazy white guy, and he's got to, like, go to the bathroom really, really bad. And he runs to the kicker stall and gets the kicker out the toilet so he can sit down and handle his business. I guess what I'm saying is it's just, okay, now you the kicker. Now you got somebody you can pick on. So now this is your stage now to come out here and mess with the band because you're a big football player. You know what I'm saying? You're the kicker, and you're about to lay down the law. And I'm sure you've got to do your little practice kicks, which I'm sure you didn't have enough time during the week through all those hitting drills you were in the middle of to practice your kicks. You know what I'm saying? So, again, yeah, have a little bit of respect before one of the linemen slap you around a little bit.
So moving right into the last word on the street, it's pretty interesting to think about this one. I wanted to bump this by you guys. On the fifth quarter, there was a post from the BlueCoats. Well, not from the BlueCoats, but someone from the fifth posted an excerpt or the thread from the Drum Corps Planets forum. I'm actually a member of this, and I have forgot. But when I was starting the show, I was trying to, you know, get out to as many people as I could. But basically, the guy is putting out and said that he's trying to open up some avenues for HBCU band students to march DCI. Now, of course, it's during the summer, so, you know, you can do this in between you know, marching season or in between your college profession or your college academia if you're not in summer school, of course. But, of course, it costs money, you know, and that's, of course, the main thing. And that's one of the things the guy is talking about is that, you know, it's getting less and less diverse. And they want to do as much as they can to get the BlueCoats, you know, full of good players. But it's basically how he kind of prefaces the conversation. I'll just read a little bit. I won't read the entire thing, but his name is Derek Gibson. He's the BlueCoats brass caption head. And he says, I hope we can get some support on this on here. I had an idea to reach out to the HBCU community after seeing a lot of screaming trumpets and similar raw talent on HBCU YouTube videos. To me, this could be a win-win situation. Drum corps are getting more and more expensive and therefore less diverse. This helps combat this. There are many talented musicians at these schools that I would like to encourage to audition for BlueCoats by partially offsetting the cost. I think it is a widening the net to attract the most talent. I think there needs to be more cooperation, outreach, and appreciation between show-style marching arts and chorus-style marching arts. So if you or anyone you know feel passionate about exposing or encouraging drum corps participation to a culture of band students who may not be familiar with our style, please contribute to the fund. Thanks. Okay, I actually did read the whole thing. So before I say anything else, I want to ask you, Bo Jay, what do you think about my man Derek here and this post from BlueCoats?
Well, it's, you know, he pretty much said it all. You know, he recognizes the skill, especially in the upper brass area. You know, depending on which videos he watches, it's pretty obvious. If you are watching a lot of swag videos, you're going to hear a lot of screaming trumpets. You know, if you go back and you catch the right video of Norfolk with the Dizzies, you know, you're going to hear a lot of screaming trumpets. So I think he's pretty much noticing and probably just trying to expand the culture of marching music as a whole. And I think that's good for, you know, HBCU players to look into that too, because I recently just started getting into the DCI and the Vanguard and the Santa Clara and a couple of the drum corps. And, man, those guys are amazing. The sound that guys put out, the power that those guys play with, I mean, and the discipline, it's different. You know, the commands, the field commands, it's totally different. But I like it. I mean, if somebody wants to get into it, if they're a music major, I definitely would say to do it. Why wouldn't you? Why wouldn't you want to advance yourself musically and get your hands in a lot of different things? I think that's a good thing that guy's trying to do, especially if he's talking about supporting some students, maybe financially challenged, you know. That should ring in a lot of people's ears. Hey, this guy's trying to financially help you expand yourself musically, go ahead and jump on it. And I'm sure that goes out to percussionists too. You know, so yeah, I think it's a good look. I think it's potentially something that could maybe revolutionize a couple of things in the band world.
Okay. Rashad, what you think, man?
Well,
Yeah, I definitely think it's a good thing. I tried to do that myself when I was in college, man. I really wanted to do Corps while I was off for the summer. But my parents said, nope, you need to work. It's not so much the money, how much it costs, it's the fact that you need to be bringing in some money. So to work, I went. I did get the chance to do some senior drama Corps after I graduated from college. I think that one of the guys was kind of particularly about one of the things he said in particular was the term raw talent. Mm-hmm. And one of the guys I noticed said he was a little offended by that. I don't know. You can kind of look at that a couple of different ways. One way, yeah, maybe he should have humbled himself a little bit, because the thing he's got to realize is that show style people, just like drum corps people, think they're on the top of their game. And show style people, we are at the top of our game for what we do. And drum corps are on the top of their game for what they do. But there are some things that they are better at than us, and vice versa. And when my man said raw talent, I think what he's referring to, like if you're thinking about screaming trumpets, okay, if you've got a section of five or six screaming trumpets and they can all get up there, but they're not all perfectly in tune, versus when you get to drum corps, they're going to demand, I don't care what your range is, they're going to demand that you play in tune. So I think he looks at it from that standpoint for us, quote-unquote, raw talent. And that goes from everything. You know, once again, you look at some baritones and they're playing high B flats and things, that may not be something that you're seeing a lot of from the core style school. You know, so when you're trying to look from a recruiting standpoint, like, wow, like I really want to build up, you know, my drum corps, and you're looking at, you know, what's happening in the core world, and you look at the show style, say, wow, these baritones, they're amazing over here. I mean, they play like trumpets. You know, they're not the most in tune, but, man, we can work with them. I think that's kind of how he looks at that, you know. So I also saw on Drum Corps Planet, I saw the link there, and I saw that somebody was responding to him. Two things caught my attention. One was the fact that he says that there's a lot of negative comments from the drum corps people towards show style bands a lot. And that does happen. And that is a very unfortunate thing that comes from the drum corps and the core style bands, and even a lot of, you know, core style band directors and things. And it's very unfortunate. It hurts music. But these guys get on there and they say, oh, this is the worst drum line ever. You know, and blah, 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 blah. I can understand you saying, yeah, you know, that was entertaining, but it wasn't the cleanest thing ever. You know, but for them just to try to drag people through the mud like they do sometimes, particularly not understanding, like, okay, yes, that maybe not have been as clean, but, heck, we played 40 different drum cadences. You played one or two.
Right, right.
You know, the other thing is, the other guy commented on the fact that, you know, how are you going to make this something that HBCU students want to go to when, you know, they're not, they may not necessarily like that style. And I think that person may or may not have a good understanding of the HBCU student, because there are a lot of students that have their only experience with core style is bad, just like a lot of core style students have a negative appearance of show style. But there's a lot of us, particularly those who are on the fifth quarter, I think, who have started to gain a little bit of knowledge about what's going on, that they love drum beat record. They absolutely love them because they can appreciate the talent that's out there. And it is nice to see somebody from the drum corps world actually look back and say, wow, wait a second, we appreciate what you guys are doing as well. You know, so I think that person might need to just, you know, just keep an open mind about the fact that, yeah, we might actually know some things about what that. But to the guy offering the scholarship, great work.
Yeah, and you know, it's really just really boiled down to, you know, black versus white, basically. Anything that's perceived to be all black is going to not be as intelligent or not as technical and not as textbook as, you know, a lot of potential, a lot of raw talent and these type of things. But of course, without the refinement that's needed and necessary, I totally get that. I mean, you could apply that to black business. You could apply that to anything that's perceived as all black. We going to hear those same words. I was just kind of surprised at how my man, the first reply on the actual drum corps planet forum, how he's replying, but at the same time he's like trying to criticize, and he's like, no, don't do it because of these things. But how he words it, it's like, oh, I just have these concerns. Like, you know what I mean? But then there was definitely, if people ever see the thread, you know, I definitely advise people to go in there and check it out. You know, you just see, you know, just the lack, like you said, like the lack of an open mind, or just a lot of narrow-mindedness. And then a lot of times maybe people didn't mean it a certain way. Maybe the wording, you know, we are reading people's words and we're not hearing the tenor in their voices, you know, when they say certain things. I saw one guy on here says, my son goes to an HBCU and some of those bands are really, really good now, you know. So he may have been trying to be nice, but the whole hearing some of those bands are good now, it's like, well, homeboy, they've been good for over 100 years, brother. Like, what you talking about? Like, you know, we could definitely get those signals crossed. But, you know, I thought that I think it's a good thing. And just putting it out there for any of our listeners, like my man Emmanuel or anybody that's young that's out there want to get that experience, you may want to holler at them and, you know, they can see about splitting those costs. And I think a guy, James Riles, I think a guy, a percussion guy, actually did the show with him one time. He was talking about, you know, connecting a lot of, you know, the technical aspects of drum and bugle corps, just the precisions of drill and how that will help out. You know, he even talked about Dr. Davenport and, you know, just talking about taking classes on drill and learning drill. I think, you know, those avenues are opened up. And, you know, we're able to maybe implement some things. So it's a win-win for everyone. But, of course, you know, it's those people who kind of like to hide behind their words, or, you know, they like to hide behind their profession, like journalism. They like to hide behind the craft of marching arts to kind of say certain things that they want. So that's kind of maybe, you know, what's happening here. One person... and I'm not sure who this is, but on this thread, I did want to read what they said. Of course, there was a couple of many arguments started by some people about this. The person said that, I think in response, they said something. I didn't write the Urban Dictionary definition. You'll also notice exactly what you said can be applied towards the term HBCU. This is actually the response to what this person said. About you can be applied to the term HBCU. The person said the term HBCU means historically black college and universities, applies to institutions founded before 1964, created to provide opportunities for African American youth, as to not be excluded interest based on race. With the Civil Rights Act of 1964, any school receiving federal funding cannot discriminate against applications based on race, which is why so many HBCUs have high non-black student populations. This is one thing that I hope some of the listeners are listening to about. Overall, the average enrollment of non-African Americans at HBCUs is 20% based on federal figures, and this is now the national average across the board. Some schools have higher rates, like West Virginia State, at 51% of European descent, of course, because, you know, there are folks that do not like to be referred to as, you know, just strictly white and would prefer to use their nationality, where they're from, in their statistics. And as little as low as 11% African American. Bluefield has 81% European descent, and Kentucky State at 33%. White and 44% African American. So these figures are rising collectively as an enrollment increases, as many HBCUs position themselves as quality liberal arts business and professional institutions. Okay. So it's just, again, something else about HBCUs. You know, we're definitely talking about show style marching bands, but again, a lot of these schools have a higher non-black student enrollment than most people think. So, of course, this idea, oh, it's a black school where it's like, oh, they poor, they don't have nothing. It's like, no, that's not necessarily the case.
And I think that's definitely important to at least help with the financial side of those things. So I really wanted to read those things out for our listeners. We're getting to the end of the show. Jay, I wanted to ask you, man, been on Triple Plus Platinum here with us. You got anything going on this week that you're looking forward to or anything that you want us to know about?
Well, yeah, you know, gonna be we usually get up, watch the Bayou Classic together with the fellas, with the old band heads. We end up being in the same place. So that's probably what we're going to do if I get in touch with those guys.
Oh, that's what's up. And I forgot you from Detroit. So this Thanksgiving is special to you because your Lions should be on TV on a good national stage.
We're going to do that. We're going to do that there.
That's what's up, man. So right quick, man, before I let you out the thing, can you let us know something that you're thankful for?
Man, I'm thankful for my family, man. I'm thankful for my health. I'm thankful for the things I have. I don't have much, but, man, I thank God every day, and definitely not just on Thanksgiving, man, because that's man making you think about that. God made me think about the things I have every day, you know, and me being grateful for what I have not makes me desire more. You know what I'm saying?
That's what's
and,
up, man.
That's it, man. Yeah.
That's cool, man. We sure appreciate it, Jay, man. Like you said, man, you welcome to call in anytime, man. Let us know, and you're welcome on the show, man. So, man,
all
right,
man. One more thing on the head tip, though. I got to tell all the video people that do these tapes, man, y'all got to start taping the drum section more in the stands because sometimes I get that itch. I hear the band, I'm satisfied, but sometimes I want to see the drum section. I want to see what the tenor's doing. I want to see
what
the bass drum's doing. And as long as I can still hear the band, I'm straight with looking at the drum section. I'm cool with looking at the dancers for the whole song. You know what I'm saying? It's cool. I get to see the cymbals. Do they flash? But the camera move, and I don't get to see the whole flash. I might want to go next door to these little dogs, you know?
Right.
So that's all I want to say. Shout out to Killer Kev Promotions, y'all. Y'all go ahead and subscribe to Killer Kev. He do them good videos.
Yeah, man, I sure subscribed to him. I saw a couple of things I think he did, Elizabeth City State, I think. So, yeah, Killer Kev is up there, man. We sure appreciate it, Jay.
For sure.
All right, Rashad, man, I asked you the same question, man. Is there anything on the map and on the radar for Block Band Music and Publishing?
Always, my brother. Of course, I'll be checking out. I'll be happy to be checking out the Bayou Classic this weekend. Bayou Classic is the Bayou Classic changed my life because you know if I hadn't seen the Bayou Classic back in 1993 I probably would not have gone to one of these great HBCUs, but it's one of those things that caught my attention. I saw Southern and it changed my life, man. And so band directors, please understand, put money behind these bands because they grab students. But anyway, I will be watching Bayou Classic. As far as Block Band is concerned, as we're wrapping up the season, we're continuing to push out Christmas music. We've already got an arrangement of some stuff for Martin Luther King Day. As you know, the bands need to start thinking about that. If you're doing a parade, we've got an arrangement of Lift Your Voice and Sing for Marching Band, as well as Happy Birthday by Stevie Wonder in tribute to Martin Luther King. We have concert band music, traditional concert music that people can get. We've got indoor drumline equipment that people need to start thinking about, because if you're using your outdoor drumsticks and mallets inside, you're really doing a disservice to your band. Also, the Block Band staff, as a staff, we will be going to the Honda Battle of the Bands, Joe. So we are
nice.
Yes, sir. Block Band continues just as we try to support everything that we possibly can as far as show style bands are concerned. We just are asking, you know, for those bands to support us as we are working very hard to support them and understand them.
Well, that's what's up, man. A huge fan of Block Band Music and Publishing. I always love what you do. And right quick, man, can you name something that you're thankful for?
Yeah, man. Thank you for asking, man. It gives me an opportunity to speak on that. I am thankful for God, because God does miraculous things in my life all the time. And I'm thankful for my family. I'm thankful for my girlfriend, man. She's an incredible woman for me. My job, my business, man, my coworkers, my staff, you, Joe. Just, you know, so thankful for show style bands. I'm so thankful for everything that's going on in life right now. I'm also thankful for Netflix.
Me too on that. I hear you on that one.
Dude, I'm thankful that S.H.I.E.L.D., you know, Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. is now on Netflix. I thought.
That's what's up.
Yeah, man. But I'm just thankful for all those things, man. And that's it.
Right quick. Speaking of Netflix, have you seen Hell on Wheels?
No, what's that?
Okay, are you into Westerns?
Not really, but I guess I could be.
Okay, I kind of like Westerns a little bit, like Unforgiven and Tombstone and all those type of things. I like those joints. This one has Common in it. And Common, and it's all about the Union Pacific Railroad and Reconstruction time right after the Civil War, when, of course, the country is, quote-unquote, trying to repair itself. And you have the expansion of the railroad out to the Pacific Ocean, you know, that's, you know, has a lot to do with, you know, the expansion of the country, you know, setting down the railroads, the actual people who actually worked on the railroads. The black folks are the freedmen, as they say, who are not slaves anymore, but still get treated like slaves. You know what I'm saying? I mean, all of that stuff is really, really good. Well, Common is in it, and the main character is this white guy, and is from Meridian, Mississippi, and basically takes off. He's a Confederate soldier, and some Union soldiers do some messed up stuff to his family and all. So he goes out in search of these men who did this to his family, and then turns around and helps to assist in the railroad moving out west. You hit my nerve when you said that, because, of course, half of all my time is now diverted to seeing the show. And the second I get a break with anything, I go look at it. So I'm all over Netflix, man, just like what you're talking about. So I'm thankful for that, too, brother.
That's going to be the death of both of our businesses if we're not careful, I tell you.
Well, that's what's up, man. Well, happy Thanksgiving, Rashad. Always good to hear from you, man. I'll talk to you next week, man.
Thanks again for all you do, Joe.
All right, man. Thank you, too, man. We are thankful for BlockBand. We're thankful for our sponsors. We're thankful to God as well for allowing all of this to be possible. Thankful to all of you people who are listening, and thankful to all the people that's ever called in. Thank you to everything and everyone that's making this possible and making it a reality. I believe in what we're doing, and one day we're going to catch on and be able to start throwing out thousands of dollars of scholarships to all of our schools and a lot of these show style bands, so we can build our craft and build our schools. If you're interested in becoming a sponsor or a patron to the Marching Podcast, please contact the show and we'll give you the criteria so we can start to pub your business using our platform. We'll play your commercial, we'll post your website on our blog, and we'll help you send out your information through social media. So contact us so we can help build your business. That's all we have for the show tonight. And you're free to call in and chat with us here. Before we sign, oh no, we don't have any time for that. But I was just wondering where my transition little music was, and I ain't turned it on yet. We're so much into the conversation. But thank you to everyone again. Much thanks for 2014. It's been a good year, and we're of course increasing the listeners every year, and we're thankful to all of you. So again, we will keep it trucking. Thank you to you. You guys make sure that you have a good, thankful holiday with your families, and make sure you let everyone know that you love them. Don't be like Patrick Swayze and Ghost and say ditto. Don't be saying that, y'all. Don't be saying no ditto to people. You say you love somebody and say it to dudes. Brothers, you need to start telling your boys you love them. It ain't all necessarily all weak and all that, but I'm getting older, man, and folks, you start to understand that. You folks, you crab brothers in the band, you crab sisters, you tell each other that you love each other this year, and that things will be much better so that people know how you feel, and there'll never be a time where they will not be around and you can't let them know or express yourself. That's all the time we have for tonight. Check out the time we have on the show. Check out the time we have on the show. Check out the website, donate what's in your heart to the marchingpodcast.com. Like us on Facebook. Follow us on Twitter. Thanks to you, and thanks to you for listening. And remember, the lectures you may deliver may be very fine and true, but I'd rather get my lesson by observing what you do. Happy Thanksgiving. Feliz Dia de Pavo. And see you next time.